Under the moon of love, Shawadi Wadi. Shawadi Wadi. Dave Bartram, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Good nice to be here. I recognise you. You know, I still reckon you, even though, you know, it looks at you, you look a little bit like your dad. No offence to your mate. You're definitely familiar.
Well, there we go. I've got one of those mug shots, you know, that... That people sort of, I don't know, familiarise themselves to.
Well, anyway, because it was an age ago, wasn't it? I was, like, you know, and I remember
It's not that long ago.
It wasn't that long ago. No, it wasn't that long ago. It was only like yesterday, wasn't it? You on Top of the Pops. Because I remember, one of the things I remember on Top of the Pops with you, that horrendous mistake you made on Top of the Pops.
You can remember it. I can't.
Can't you remember that?
No.
You were doing Three Steps to Heaven, and you'd got the numbers wrong.
Didn't do the numbers.
Didn't you?
No. That's put you in your place.
Who did the numbers? They got the numbers wrong.
Romeo used to do it. It was step one.
Well, they got step one, two, and three mixed up.
I know he had a little bit of difficulty miming to it because they often insisted that you mime on Top of the Pops.
Yeah.
And I know Romeo had a bit of difficulty getting in sync.
Yeah.
And I think it sort of got to him so much that perhaps he got him in the wrong order.
I think he missed out number two or something. He had to do three twice.
I didn't know that. That's a historian that I am.
Yeah, there you go. Because that was the mid-70s. It was the middle of the 70s, wasn't it?
That would have been 1975.
Just before. I guess you were sort of just in the prequel to the sort of punk rock era.
I came along around about 77, didn't it? And we all of a sudden, from being sort of bad boys in 1974, we were regarded as sort of part of the furniture and very mainstream.
Yeah, that's right. And the suit, because the big thing, you know, you're sort of ponced up in your suits, weren't you? Loved all that.
Yeah, nice expression.
Yeah, yeah. What colour were you?
Because
it was like Spice Girls, you know, you were red, or you yellow, or you green?
No, we had a different colour every night.
Did you?
Yeah, if you didn't like green, you still had to wear it every now and again. Or, you know, same could be said for red or blue or purple.
So did you share the suits then?
Yeah, we had a number of sets of suits. I mean, we had to because they got a little bit high after a couple of performances.
Yeah.
So we had to swap them around a little bit.
Oh, so but you it wasn't necessarily your yellow suit. You know,
you might
have worn it one night and the other guys wore it the other night.
It is strange, actually, over the years, people have said to me, oh, yeah, you always wore a pink suit.
Yeah.
I didn't. I wore a blue suit, I wore a purple suit, I wore a red suit and... All the colours of the rainbow.
we talked to a few bands, and it's great to, Shawadi Wadi, because you're not played too much on the radio now, and, you know, the kids around here, they don't know about you. They don't know what a great rock and roll band you were.
Well, it was amazing, really, the last couple of years I was in the band, we actually seemed to be getting quite a lot of young kids coming to the shows.
Yeah.
They were really switching on to 70s music. I think they're a little bit... tired of the sort of clinical sounding modern stuff, and
because it was sort of rock and roll, rock and roll rockabilly? I don't know how you'd describe it.
I really would have called ours doo-wop rock
doo-wop.
And roll. Yeah, absolutely.
It's a good time. Doo-wop's always a bit good, isn't it?
Doo-wop, you know, suggests a lot of voices. We're very much a vocal band,
yeah.
And you know, it's fun music. It's the stuff that's where the name came from. Bab, bab, shawadi wadi.
Yeah,
you know, it's all about doo-wop.
And when did he? I mean, we'll get on to what you're doing now. But what did you when did you get together, you guys? Were you all sort of mates, or what happened?
73, the amalgamation of two bands,
yeah.
And we just decided to put this rock and roll extravaganza on the road rather than hiding behind our hair like a lot of bands were doing at that time.
And I mean, and so you got two bands, and then that means there must have been because there were, you were singing most of the stuff, sort of thing.
Yeah,
but, you know,
that's right.
But you know, you were. It was a sort of commune of
yeah.
Of
there was almost two of everything in a sense, but it helped sort of from an animated point of view. It made a bit of a spectacle.
And you had this sort of little dance. I mean, I know nothing's new, but there was a bit of a dance routine going on occasionally with it.
Oh, we had a few
steps
dance
and all
routines.
That.
Oh yeah, yeah. We were quite nifty on our feet in those days.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that was a few years ago, and then so what happened to the band? They all split up, did they, and went separate ways, or what? What? How did it end, really?
The band has never ceased.
Ended. Never ceased.
No, I quit at the end of 2011 to you know, concentrate on a few other things. But no, there has always been a Shiwadi Wadi right from.
And it's has it always been the sort of the core team in Shiwadi, the group members? Were they, have they stayed sort of fairly consistent?
Well, as we speak now, there are two originals remaining. It's a six-piece band these days, and Rod and Romeo are the sole surviving originals. But right from day one in 73, there's always been, obviously, they were all originals in 73. It was cut down to a seven-piece in 77, then a six-piece as we went along, you know. And sort of 38 years later, you know, we're still treading the boards.
38 years. Can you imagine doing it 38 years later?
It's a long, long time.
Because you sort of manage the boys.
I've done since 84, actually.
As well. And, you know, because my mum's got this theory that, you know, in many ways, you know, you want to put a bit of fresh blood into these groups occasionally because, you know, you're a poor old soul, you know, you haven't got as much energy as you used to have. And, you know, you want a young version of you.
I've still got plenty of energy. I've got as much as I need anyway.
And so what's it like sort of handing over the reins of sort of lead vocalist, you know, to a new kid on the block?
So it's a little bit strange to go and see somebody else sort of taking your place. And I think the new guy, Andy, who's taken my place, he's studied the videos and he does a few of my little moves and things, the little shimmies and stuff. But
does he sound a bit like you?
I suppose, in a sense, he does. I don't think anybody quite sounds like me, but he's doing an excellent job, and he fronts the band very, very well. And it's great that there's still a band out there.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, you wrote a book. Just recently written a book about what's it called? The Boys of Summer.
Yeah, I have my first piece of literature available called The Boys of Summer.
Is this a novel or a what is it? Then?
It's not fictional at all. It's it's not an autobiography. It's basically about the year of summer of 2005.
Yeah,
when the band undertook a tour of 33 caravan parks, and we didn't quite know what lay ahead.
Well, these are all sort of Pontins type style places.
They were very down market compared to Pontins, to be honest. And the facilities in a lot of these camps really were incapable of putting a show on for a band our size. And basically, over that 10-week period, all that could go wrong did go wrong, and the stories are there in The Boys of Summer of 10 weeks of hell.
2000. So what were you as you were doing campsites? Were you in caravans yourself?
That was part of the deal that our accommodation was thrown in, and to say that some of these they call them entertainers' caravans, the ones that we were given.
Yeah,
and some of them, I think the word would be squalid.
Would sum it up. Because there were six or so of you in the group, so that means I'll give you a six-berth caravan.
Trying to give you a six-berth caravan, but if you had a pair of broad shoulders, you struggled to get into some of these cots that they provided.
Because I remember I went on holiday, because Lady Watt said to me the other day, last year sometime, she got one of those deals out of the newspapers, and we went to a caravan park, £9 for the weekend.
Sounds expensive to me. After 2005.
It was like going into the set of the Jeremy Kyle show.
Yes, the tracky bottoms and the tattoos.
So you went all over the... is it just the UK, this?
This was the length and breadth of the UK, and it... it's very, very tongue-in-cheek, I've written, but it at the time, it was pretty hellish, and actually, it was tinged with tragedy as well. I lost my mum during the course of the dates, and Rod, the bass player, lost his brother, and really, it just was an extraordinary 3-month period, and that's why I decided to put pen to paper.
So you did the event and then thought, I'm going to have to write about this.
It was kind of, as we were going through it, we were chatting and saying, you know, wouldn't this make an incredible fly-on-the-wall documentary? And I started making notes, and I just couldn't believe what I'd got. And I thought, I've got to write a book. And I'd always wanted to write a book. Never really had the time to actually put aside to do it. But now I was determined I was going to do it.
I presume you've got to take a bit of kit with you, obviously, you know, so get into a... And they weren't set for you.
Well, you know, some of the gear was too big to go in some of these places. And some of the stages were the size of a postage stamp. And you know, as we said, the accommodation left a lot to be desired. And hot and cold running rats and all that sort of stuff. Yeah,
you take it with great art and you've done it with great tongue and cheek sort of thing. But you know, you've been there. You were sort of kings of Top of the Pops for a while and all that sort of
thing. Yeah, absolutely.
How do you cope with sort of like, you know, living in this sort of Grotsville? And you think, hang on a minute, I was sort of number one. I know it was a few years ago.
Well, after 33 years, which it was when we went out to do those dates, it felt a little bit like a come down, but I never thought I would have to go through a period of character building at death once I've been treading the boards for 33 years.
we'll find out more in just a moment. We've got some travel on the way. We'll see, because you've got a new... So we got the new single coming out, Black Ice, which is so there's, you're not in this, but you'll manage these guys.
That's right, yeah, they're still very dear to my heart.
And they're doing a big tour, so we'll find out all about that.
Yeah.
And I got a song that never gets played on the radio, one of your old ones.
Right.
And when I said to the boys, we've got to play this one, because no one ever plays this. I mean, I've not heard it on the radio for 30 years. They can't believe it. And I think it's a great song.
Okay? And it's going to be, is it Trocadero?
No, it's not Trocadero. Because it's a little bit of soap. Do you remember that?
Yeah, it was a top five record.
Top five record. Well, I'll do that in a minute. Okay, hold a minute, because we're just for a laugh. Okay, play it again. BBC Radio Stoke, we're talking Shwadi Wadi. Dave Bartram with us this afternoon. Hey, a little bit of soap. I quite like that. It's sort of funny, isn't it, really? A little bit of soap to wash away your tears. We've got Dave Bartram, Shwadi Wadi, in the studio with me today. Good to have you here.
And yeah, they don't write lyrics like that anymore.
A little bit
they?
Of soap. Do you write a lot of the stuff?
Yeah, we wrote a lot of, myself and Trevor Oates, wrote a lot of Shwadi Wadi stuff, including our first four hits.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah, not a lot of people really knew
about that. When you stopped getting the chart hits, was that sort of punk rock's fault, was it, that you stopped going out of favour?
I mean, we were teenage heartthrobs, and I think, you know, have had 10 years of hits was quite incredible.
Were you just after Bay City Rollers?
We sort of took on the
back of that.
On the back end of the Slade, Bay City Rollers sort of era, and along we came and
had the new boys in town.
Yeah, we were indeed, and obviously we had a massive live following, and people really just seemed to warm to the band, and you know, it's
because we use sort of heartthrobs of the day, like One Direction now sort of thing, and Take That a few years ago.
Indeed,
so
yeah.
Girls were interested.
Oh, it was quite incredible. You know, I would go out at night, and they'd literally. People running up the street and trying to grab hold of you and stuff like that. It was fantastic.
Yeah,
it was wonderful, you know. But these days, you know, they still do it, but they're all in their 80s.
I guess, you know, did you have a sort of big machine around Shwadi Wadi when you were big stars?
Oh, yeah.
Was there a machine working around it? Because it's a different age, you know, with no mobile phones and computers and all that.
The thing with the 70s, and it was also kind of pre-video when we were really, really big. I mean, the video thing was just really getting underway. But we'd go on the road, we'd spend months on end on the road.
Yeah.
With these huge articulated trucks, and as you say, the whole machine, it was incredible, and quite how it ran so smoothly, I'll never quite know.
And you sort of rolled into town, I guess it was before local radio was really kicking off, wasn't it?
Well, I remember local radio beginning, because I hail from the city of Leicester, and the first BBC radio station was actually Radio Leicester in 1967, and then obviously there was the explosion all over the country after that. So really the local radio stations were very, very important to the plot.
Yeah, that's right. And now you've retired sort of from singing, really.
Being on the road, let's put it.
On the road,
yeah.
Because that's great, but a pain at the same time.
Immensely tiring after 38 years. The road takes up your life.
Yeah.
It dominates absolutely everything. It dominates your personal life as well. And, you know, I wanted to do things like write books and stuff, and I wanted to go to my friends' weddings and occasionally, sadly, funerals. And I wanted to go out with my friends at night, and this life had been just dominating my weekends for, well, for 30 years.
It changed over the years because, you know, you were very much on your own in the old days, you know, with no phones to speak of, or mobiles indeed. And all that, no computer. You can't keep in touch very easily. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, you can keep in touch very easily. So did the sort of process of being on the road change over the years, and you get to stay in nicer hotels? Are you still in Mrs. Huggins?
Well, we stayed in a lot of lovely hotels, as you say, you know, the B&B thing. We did that in the early days. We learnt the ropes, as a lot of bands had to in those days, to build up a following. You had to get out on the road to build up your following, you know, other than being on TV. But I mean, we've stayed in some pretty plush hotels in a time, and wrecked a few as well.
How far and wide did your fame in your heyday spread? Did it spread? I get the impression that Europe would love you.
Throughout Europe, yeah. Europe was our stamping ground, yeah.
Yeah.
Indeed. We were often over to Germany and places like Denmark, Sweden, and even behind the Iron Curtain, as it was then, where it rained marriage proposals and stuff like that. It was, the hero worship in those territories was just phenomenal.
Yeah. So what was you went behind the Iron Curtain? Because you it must have been, you know, you were so cool. Over there, sort of thing.
Well, it was amazing. You know, we'd go into these places, Czechoslovakia, in Prague. I remember there were girls at the airport screaming as we got off the plane. It was extraordinary, bizarre, but wonderful at the same time.
What's it like going to a country you've never been into before, and then everyone knowing who you are? What's that feel like?
Well, it's very flattering.
Yeah,
and very exciting. And obviously, you run out and you know, I'm shouting at them in English, and they're all responding, even though half of them didn't, you know, speak a note of English. But it was phenomenal. They were so fanatical. It was almost a release for them to get out to a concert, to see a Western band.
Yeah, that's right. Did you get people dressing up as yourselves?
Not behind the Iron Curtain. Mm-hmm. I don't think they could afford to be truthful, but over here, I mean, they still do. And a lot of people, especially, you know, with the band as it is now, a lot of people go out to party and they don their crepes and drapes and their pleated skirts.
Because you can still put, you know, if you're doing a few gigs and things, you still do, you know, stick an old Shawadi Wadi song on, everyone leaps up. So even the kids that, you know, weren't around in those days.
Yeah, absolutely. I remember being over in Indonesia in Jakarta, and I went to a club, quite a dingy club over there. And as I walked through the door, the first record I heard was Dancing Party by Shawadi Wadi, and the people just flooded onto the floor. I just felt wow. You know,
it
just felt, you know, just an incredibly warm feeling.
Now you got some gigs coming up with Shawadi Wadi.
I haven't.
Not yet. Well, you've got the Shawadi Wadi that you've sort of left, but you know, you're still very much part of Wolverhampton at the Christmas time, March in Warrington, and May. Because we're looking a long way ahead for that, aren't we, in crew?
Yeah, we've got stuff right up to the end of 2014 for the boys.
And your book. Where's the more important thing? This is the new you, isn't it?
The Boys of Summer.
The Boys of Summer. So are you going to write? Have you got another book in here? Is there something else going?
I'm just adding the final touches, really, the finishing touches to my second one, which is a bit of an epic, which it's developing. It'll be almost like War and Peace by the time I've finished it.
Which
covers the 40 years and a lot of stories. It's not really autobiographical. It's more about 150 rock and roll stories from the cities of Great Britain.
Have you got a lot of pictures, or did people take pictures of you a lot, or
we decided not to go down that route, but basically because the books are, they're more fun, they're more stories about you know, a life of rock and roll, rather than being autobiographical. So I didn't particularly think people would particularly want to read a book particularly about my life, but they love rock and roll stories.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, great to meet you. Great to see you looking so well. Not as if you're so old anyway, but you know what I mean. Shawadi Wadi. We'll play the new single from Shawadi Wadi 2013.
That's not Shawadi Wadi, it's Dave Bartram.
Dave Bartram. Oh, it's Dave Bartram. Well, this is you as well. Great stuff, okay. So this is you doing your thing, and you're doing something in Leicester in a few weeks' time, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm coming out of retirement, so to speak, to do a show which people have been leaning on me a little bit to do for a while, and I'm really looking forward to it, and it may be the first of many.
Maybe the first. Very good. But Dave Bartram, lovely to see you. Let's play your song, and we'll catch you around, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Okay.
Cheers.